Again, we had gotten some more questions online. People wanted, had some suggestions for different topics or different things that they wanted you to talk about. So I'm just gonna, give you a few topics and see if you could share a little bit on those different things. The first thing was in regards to the five. Well, I guess what they wrote, the five evils, the five, kam, krodh, mod, lob, moh, ankar, lust, anger, greed, pride, and attachment. And in regards to a Sikh, how one maybe deals with these things, or, that's just one of the things that in everyday life that we have to deal with. So,
first of all, hello. We haven't been together for a while. So I'm grateful to my brother here that he asked me to sit down in this lovely yard and talk together. You know, living on the earth in a human body carries with it certain challenges and certain responsibilities. Because this body is such a gift. We went through 8.4 million incarnations to get it. And it's only in this body that we can relate to infinity and understand who we are. And the course of life is an arc from birth to death. And you know, at birth, there is no kam, krodh, moh, ankar, lobh. These things don't exist at birth. Why don't they exist? They don't exist because everyone is born in unisonness with their own infinite identity. Problem is, we forget who we are. When we forget who we are, as we get older, we start to believe what people tell us who we are. We start to believe that we are not God. That we are just some little person. And slowly we forget. And in that process of forgetting, we begin to identify with our ego. I am Mr. So-and-so. I am Miss So-and-so. We used to do a fun meditation, which is you sit with someone else and you say to them, who are you? Here, I'll play it with you. Okay, ready?
Ready.
You answer. Who are you?
Guru Mastak.
Who are you?
God.
Who are you?
I'm you.
Who are you?
I'm a human being.
Vaheguru. Okay, try to do that for 5 minutes. We went for 10 seconds. 5 minutes, one person, all they say is, who are you? And the other person replies. Then you switch, and the second person says, who are you, to the first person. The point of this is interesting because all you can say when you're the questioner is, who are you? You can't comment or anything. Is to go through the layers of identity and the layers of self-perception to get in touch with your real identity. It's very difficult to talk for 5 minutes. Who are you? It seems like an easy thing, but it's not an easy thing. So in this lifetime, we're given a certain amount of energy. You know, it may be X, Y, or Z. Some people have more energy, some people have less energy. So the fundamental question of life is, God has given you the pranas. What are you going to do with them? That's the fundamental question. When pranas leave, it's time to leave. When pranas are here, it's time to work. So, we have five elements. We're made up of five elements and three gunas. So the energies of the gunas flow through the five elements, and that comprises the physical form. Each of the five elements has associated with it a positive and a negative. So, element of earth can be greed, or it can be grounding. Element of water can be flow, flexibility, adaptability, or it can be lust. These energies are natural energies. They're not so much enemies as they are something you have to understand and deal with. Guru calls them enemies because you have to face them. But in facing them, you understand them and you deal with them. You can't avoid them. You can't avoid them. If you're made of five elements, you have to deal with the five elements. There's no way to avoid it. So, you have to recognize each energy. And the first stage is, I am experiencing greed. I am experiencing pride. I am experiencing lust. Whatever you're experiencing, you acknowledge that you're experiencing it. Then the question is, what do you want to do with it? I'm sitting and meditating. I sit and meditate. I'm chanting. Vaheguru, 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 Vaheguru. And I open my eyes, and some pretty young girl is walking by. And the thought goes in my mind and says, she's a juicy, pretty little thing. What a sexy little girl. And it creates a cut in my thought pattern. Now, do I go into that thought and follow it into a desire, and then do I act on that desire? Or do I cut it across? Because it cut across me, now I have to cut back. So, question is, can you filter it? Can you recognize it for what it is? Or does it grab you and take you and you follow it? For that, you need pratyahara. You need to be able to control your own mind. And the way you control your own mind is through your breath and through mantra. So I'm sitting there and I'm chanting, Vaheguru, 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 Vaheguru. And in that process, I am consciously cutting. I'm not denying, I'm not fighting, I'm not resisting, I'm not canceling consciously with my thought. I'm just allowing it to get cancelled in the cut of the mantra and the neutrality of the flow of my thought. But it's a conscious process. It's a choice. So every time you experience the energy, whatever it is, first step is to recognize what you are experiencing. Because otherwise it catches you unawares. If you're not alert, you're caught. If you're alert, you can recognize what you're experiencing and say, aha! I am experiencing greed. I am experiencing lust. I'm experiencing whatever I'm experiencing. And in that time, you can cut it. But it's a constant pratyahara. Now, once you cut it, where do you take the energy of it? You have to put that energy somewhere. Energy of second chakra and fifth chakra are connected. So, the same energy that allows you to create things through the power of your word is the same energy of your sexual energy. It's the same energy. Question is, do you want to use it to create something? A baby? That's creating something. Or do you want to use it to create something through your art? Through your what you give to the world? You can consciously redirect the energy and use it. Sometimes the best antidote for being horny is to have a great work to work on, a great book, a great piece of music, something wonderful that you need to create that you can pour your energies into. It's a matter of choice. Where do you want to put your energy? And you have to consciously make that choice, because whether you realize it or not, you're always making that choice. Just question is the choice a subconscious choice or a conscious choice? You understand? You can pray all day, it won't do it. You have to do it.
How does one start to become more conscious of their thoughts and the things that they're thinking, and in regards to these, you know, lust, anger, greed, pride, you know, what are the, some are harder than others for sure, so.
Waking up is hard to do. There was a song, waking up is hard to do. I think that it was breaking up, but I'm making a new song, waking up. It is hard to get up in the morning, isn't it? It's hard to wake up in life. Yogi Bhajan always used to say, are you consciously conscious that you have a consciousness? So, really the question you're asking is, when you get caught up in the flow of your perceptions and the flow of your thoughts and the flow of your feelings, you begin to identify with them. So these are my feelings, these are my thoughts. This is what I'm seeing, this is what I'm hearing. But there's a part of your consciousness that's always separate from that. And when you meditate, you stimulate it, because life without the Ajna Chakra is not much fun. The fun of it is that you can watch yourself. You know that sense of the point of watching, the observer. But sometimes, I'm sure you've experienced it, you say something and then there's something in your head that says, listen to what I just said, that was a silly thing to say. You know that check within yourself that's watching you. Because when you're entirely caught up in the flow of your energy and the flow of your feeling and perception and emotion, you lose that point of observation, of being able to see yourself. So the first quality of a yogi is that you can watch your mind. Your mind becomes not your master, but something that is there to serve you, and you can examine it and watch how it works and use it consciously. So, how to wake up? I don't know any way to wake up except wake yourself up. You have to practice, you have to do your sadhana, you have to do your banis, you have to do your discipline, you have to train your mind, you have to practice your breath. It's your own self-discipline. Because your own discipline is the thing which should be most precious to you. Everybody has all kinds of excuses why they don't want to do this or don't want to do that. I don't have time to meditate. I can't get up early in the morning because I'd be too tired during the day, blah, blah, blah. There's always a bunch of reasons. But when you develop a flow within yourself and a natural habit, it becomes part of your tune-up, part of your training yourself. And we have such fantastic tools. Everything we have, we need. We've been given perfect Gurbani. We've been given the power of the breath. We've been given the power of mantra. All these tools are at our hands to experience and to use to transform our own consciousness. So it's a constant process to do that. You can either walk around and say, how can I know? How can I find out? How can I do this? Or you can do it. And doing it becomes a daily habit, a daily discipline, a daily awareness. It becomes your tool to experience who you are. So, waking up is hard to do.